Okay, I'm trying to figure out if I'm live or not yet. Yeah, I think I see the fact that I'm live now. All right. Okay, I'll check the audio. If it's audible, sir, if you could give me a heads up on that. The audio is audible enough. Okay, great. So we'll begin whenever you let me know, whenever you give me a heads up about it. Okay. Yes, it is. Also, the internet is extremely painfully slow nowadays. So, if there is a lag, apologies in advance. I hope that it doesn't happen today. Usually, between 12 to 8 on weekdays, the internet is pretty slow. I think because it's being taken up across the world and people are working from home. So, but hopefully, this will work. All right. I'll start after a few minutes. Just having a casual conversation in front of the camera. I hope the video is clear because I'm getting a message from sir that it's not. The lag is expected because, as I said, the internet load is, I think, a lot these days, so it might be an issue. Apologies for it, though. Just give me a minute. I will start in a bit. I'm waiting for a couple of more people to join in, replying to that comment. All right, so thank you for the heads up, sir. I think we're good to begin. Just, I want to say hi before we begin, everybody. Thank you for tuning in. And just a bit of an introduction about myself. I am Sanya, and I'm going to talk today about the facets of legal journalism and court reporting. Well, before we begin, I also want to thank Tarveen sir for allowing me to be able to speak about something that I do professionally and something that I love professionally, and be able to speak about it on the forum. Also, considering the fact that all of us are tuning in and finding ways to engage and motivate and learn, even though they are trying times, we're not able to really come together and talk. Technology is helping us do that, so it's we should be grateful and we should cherish that. So it's amazing. All right, so a brief introduction about myself. I am currently working with an organization called LiveLaw. For those of you who are not familiar with what LiveLaw is, it is a platform, media platform, which has a niche area of the legal news, legal updates, legal articles. So the niche area of this media organization is of legal topics, legal news, legal stuff, basically all everything legal. We are our motto is also all about law. So when you open the website, this is the first thing that strikes. Apart from that, I am also associated with an organization called Posh at Work, which is an organization which assists other organizations to comply with the sexual harassment at workplace laws, which makes me a posh expert. These days you call those people posh consultants and posh experts. So I'm currently doing both the things, but today whatever I'm going to be speaking is going to be in my personal capacity. I'm not representing any organization. It's all going to be some basics, bits and pieces of experience that I've had only in the legal journalism sphere. You know what requirements are needed, or what kind of work is actually needed when when you're getting news on your palms, and what kind of stuff is required, especially now since the crisis has begun, the pandemic has begun. What has happened is that I feel the only link between the courts and the world is, I think, court reporters and legal journalists. Because whatever is happening in the court is not really visible to anybody except the press. So there's a press room in the Supreme Court in across courts. So I primarily report in the Supreme Court, and whatever's happening is visible to the press room, and we're able to get updates through the video conference screen, which is available in the press room. Anyway, so going on, moving on, I'd like to now talk about what is legal journalism. Right, just give me one second. So legal journalism is a niche sector, a niche area, a specialized area of journalism. Like, there are political journalists and investigative journalists. There are legal journalists who report in the courts of law. Apart from that, they also do columns, opinions, articles, videos which are centric to the legal sphere only, and they don't deviate from that usually. It's an avoidable thing to do because considering the fact that you have to be very factual based when you're a legal journalist, so it's better not to have any kind of political ideology which is public out there, especially on your professional forums. So yes, also I'd like to talk about how legal journalism has evolved over the years. Back in time when news was not very easily accessible, and what we used to hear in courts used to get reported the next day, or through the radio, not immediately. Since then, legal journalism especially has evolved a lot. Now everything that is spoken in the courts is directly reportable, and journalists and court reporters are allowed to do that. Of course, there are restrictions imposed on that in terms of you can't just post anything without a context. You know, it's very. I'll get to that how that is required. But so yeah, it's evolved a lot, and you know, all of these aspects of having the news on your palm immediately, within a span of a second of when it is spoken in the courtroom, it is just tremendous how it goes. Since that time, now social media has evolved, and we have legal channels, legal social media websites, where you can just peruse through and know what happened at the end of the day, or even during the day, what's going on in the courts. When you're in another courtroom, you may get to know what's happening in another courtroom. So that is what court reporters and legal journalists do. They get the news from what is inside a courtroom out there to be able to, give access to the world about what really happened and what really, how it happened, basically. All right. And of course, then there is this other aspect of court reporting, which is again a very niche area. Now, I want to talk about how I have not been a very experienced person when it comes to reporting or journalism. To give a short understanding of that, I'd like to say that I passed out of law school in 2013. And for 5 years after that, I worked in a litigation chamber. I was practicing full-fledgedly and going to courts regularly across the city in Delhi. And I really enjoyed it. But as life would have it, as luck would have it, last year I kind of deviated a little bit, or should I say I changed my career path. And I began working in the prevention and sexual harassment sector first. So that is where the deviation began. And last year, there is an organization called the Center for Law and Policy Research. Now, this particular organization also has a portal called Supreme Court Observer. And I began my reporting with this particular firm, this particular organization. And what they did was, report on only constitutional matters and only in the Supreme Court. So that is where my experience for reporting in the Supreme Court directly started. Also, last year when it started, the Ayodhya matter was going on. And I would like to call myself lucky that I began my career in reporting, so as to speak, from that particular judgment. Now, from that particular matter, sorry. Now, I didn't really have any skills, and so far as reporting is concerned, because I was a lawyer who was practicing for 5 years and who was in the primarily in the litigation sector and allied sectors, prevention of sexual harassment and all of that. But this was something that I was enjoying, and I was not full-fledgedly employed with this organization called Center for Law Policy Research, SC Observer. But I was like on a contract, I was working on a contract, and then I started going there whenever I had the time. But what I found myself smuggling time out of all the work that I was doing just to go and report on the Ayodhya matter. And that is when I realized, this was somewhere in August 2019, that I think I like this. I like this more. And I think I'm okay at it. I think I can manage it. Now, Ayodhya ended. Ayodhya matter ended. It was a marathon of 40 days of arguments. And let me tell you, the constitutional bench for at least, I think, 20 days or so, used to sit from 10 o'clock to 5 o'clock. And they used to, continuously hear arguments. And I somehow managed doing that in the first, in the starting of my career as a legal journalist. And so this is where it began, and then Ayodhya ended. And of course, there was a lull in terms of court reporting then. And then I moved on. I think I reached out to LiveLaw somewhere around November 2019. And then I started working with LiveLaw. Another thing I'd like to really, really point out is that for me at least, it is very important to be able to work in an organization where there is some level of fluidity and flexibility. Both of the organizations that I'm currently associated with have that. A lot of people are okay with procedures, with timelines, and etc. But I think with LiveLaw, the good thing about it is that it did not restrict my field or sphere, and I was able to allow to do whatever I wanted if I was delivering and effectively delivering. And I think that is now the need of the hour, especially now that we are seeing in this crisis. I think all lawyers and all professionals, for that matter, in the private sector are realizing that, you know, being very, you know, time conscious, that you have to be in office and you have to punch and, you know, do all of that, you know, in order to deliver successfully. It's not really how you are able to deliver. Delivery of work is all about how good you are at your work and not about whether you're able to get to a particular place or not. That's my personal opinion. Going back to legal journalism now. So I started working with LiveLaw about, I think it's been 6 months now, and full-fledgedly reporting in the Supreme Court. Now, let me tell you that to be a court reporter in the Supreme Court specifically, you have to have a BA LLB degree, a law degree. Now, it is even more essential now since the 2015 circular. Now, there was a circular which the Supreme Court had you know, introduced in 2015. Now, there were norms which were followed before that also. But specifically in 2015, they initiated a circular which said that you have to report. You're only allowed to, among other things, you're only allowed to report that if you have a law degree. Now, I think why it's important, the rationale of this was that, you know, law reporting is totally different from court reporting. When you're reporting in the court, when you're reporting a matter in court, it is extremely essential to be able to understand what is going on in the courts. And I think being a lay person who, I won't say a lay person, somebody who's not studied law, might not be able to understand or get the hang of what is going on in the court. You know, some, even near now, even for people who've had years of experience, some terms are still alien to them. I think it's the rationale of this was to be able to allow only those people to report who are able to make sense of what was going on in the courts. And I think it makes sense to do that. I remember when I started practicing also in the beginning of my career, it took me, I think I was maybe slow or whatever, but it took me a good 6 months to understand what was even going on in the courts and to get the hang of what was going on in the courts. But, you know, just finding my way around and understanding what's going on in courts, names of judges, faces of judges, all of those things come only if you are in the, you know, fraternity, if you're a part of it. But that in no way means that you can't be a court reporter, you can't be a legal journalist if you want to do so directly after you pass out. I think that's great, even better to do that. For me, I would say fortunately or unfortunately so, however you want to call it, I got into it after 5 years of practicing, and it did serve me well in a way, because I think I became better at what I do in the court reporting sector, because I had more insight than people who did not practice. And also I had a little bit of a foundation. I knew my way around the courts. I knew how it worked. I knew the filing procedures. So for me, it was a little bit easier, and I was able to give better or more inputs because I was practicing earlier. But of course, that in no way means, like I said, if you want to do it straight out of college, you're passionate, you know that you want to do it. When I passed out of law school, I did not really know what I want to do, but I always loved to write, and I always loved to articulate, you know, talk about somebody else in a way that I thought was the right way to put it, bare facts, but an articulate way to put it. So I always liked to do it, but never really found my way. And to be fairly honest, I come from a family of lawyers, and being in a conventional litigation sector is something which is expected out of, in a lot of cases, is expected out of people who come from lawyers' families to be in the litigation sphere or be in the firm sphere. And that's very good, that's very nice if you like it. But if you're not good at it, and if you're not able to get the hang of it as good as the others, then you might as well not do it. And I think I couldn't have, like, never say never, but I couldn't have really sustained myself as long as I thought I would in the beginning of the litigation sector. All right. So, yes, going back to what is effective reporting now. Now, reporting is not just being in the court and typing out or writing or jotting down whatever is being spoken. Okay, now that also takes a lot of effort. Just exactly writing everything what is being spoken is also a lot of effort, just to be fairly honest. But, you know, just 1 second, sorry. But the idea is to write something which is more of a, you know, which is bare facts, which is talking about how what is spoken, you know, exactly how it was done. And, you know, just the fact that, sorry. Without cut, you know, basically culling out what is the right information and what is important and bringing it out. Now, when lawyers are arguing in court, and judges are, the bench and the bar are talking to each other, discussing a matter, or the bench is making observations and the lawyer is putting in an argument. It all happens very fast. And sometimes you lose track if you're not paying attention. And that happens fairly often, especially for the most experienced people who are lawyers. And even for court reporters who've been in this sector for very, very long also. For someone like me who's just been at it for the last 7-8 months, it's very common. But yes, it's very, very important to be extremely alert when you're reporting in court. I'll tell you why that is. Back in 2011, there was a matter of the Vodafone case, which senior advocate Harish Salve sir was arguing. And when he finished his arguments that day, a particular news agency misquoted him. Now there was a law. There were a couple of court reporters. Of course, it was a big matter, and lots of court reporters generally want to be in the court when a big matter is being argued or an important matter is being argued, especially with industry stalwarts in the court. And you know, it was being argued, and when he got out of the court and he opened the news, or I think he read the news later. He found out that he was misquoted in that particular case. And of course, what misquoted, I mean, by misquoted, I mean, he, what was reported was not exactly what he had argued. So he filed an application in the court about this. And at that time, the bench made some observations that, yes, we are going to, you know, figure this out. This can't go on like this. Immediately after, there was an incident, there was a circular released after that in 2015, and you know, these norms became stricter, and you had to be somebody who holds a law degree and everything to be able to report in the Supreme Court especially. So immediately right after that, Justice Gogoi's bench, the then Chief Justice, Justice Gogoi in 2015, he was in the court, and it was his court, and a journalist was present in that court. And I think he was in the middle of the, you know, where the bench is and the bar is standing. So he was somewhere there, and that kind of irked Justice Gogoi. And he stated to the journalist, I'd like to read it out. I'd like to quote him. So he said, "Most of the judges do not like to be quoted about their observations made during a debate. In the course of the debate, we make certain tentative observations. We say without mincing words. You're most welcome so long as your reporting is accurate." This is what Justice Gogoi had said to that reporter. So he said that, you know, we don't like to be quoted when we're in court, especially when we're only making observations. Because during debates, during discussions in court, we say certain things which we don't think before speaking, not effectively, but because we don't want to mince words, we speak our mind, our legal mind. And so he did say that. And I think it's very important to remember that when you're a court reporter, when you're reporting something, it doesn't have to be verbatim. It shouldn't be verbatim all the time, especially when you're quoting or when you're writing about reporting live about an argument which is going on in court. It has to be a crux of the argument. It has to be your understanding of the argument, not what you think about the argument. So your understanding about the argument in small, in short words has to definitely be out there and nothing else. And of course, accuracy, I would say, is I think the number one priority when you're a reporter, apart from being articulate, of course, which can be a polished skill, which can be a derived and evolved skill. And it also can be somebody who has a knack of it and who's worked on it over the years. So both are extremely possible, and it is possible to be good at it even if you don't have an act for it. It's not like it's rocket science. And yeah, of course, then I'd like to say that, you know, the fact that these observations sometimes... So what happens is when we're doing live reporting, we are usually live tweeting. So there's an application called Twitter, where you tweet, you send posts. I think the word range is about 170, I don't remember, somewhere about 200 words or something. And you basically have to, from our platform, we tweet whatever's happening in the court and we give live updates. And usually, there are lots of other media houses who do this. In fact, all news channels, all newspapers, they all have court reporters and journalists who are legal people in the courts for that particular organization. And everybody is there and everybody tweets and everybody, most oftenly, they exchange messages, they tweet. But what happens is sometimes one person, if they make a wrong tweet or they say miss out on some important detail and they tweet without context, sometimes it, you know, because it's been tweeted and it's on a public platform, it is visible to everybody. And if somebody has not heard it, they might copy it or they might, you know, pick up from there. And then what happens, because everything is so fast now, the entire news, you know, sector, they get the same news, which is in effect wrong. And nobody can point a finger at anybody because everybody knows, they can't even say that we copied it. And but the person who wrote it knows that it was them who started the chain. So that happens not very often because we try our best to be as alert as possible, but we are human and these things do happen. But jokes apart, the repercussions of doing that, of making wrong observations in tweets, of making wrong, of doing wrong reporting are manifold. You can let your imagination run wild and see if there's a news which is reported incorrectly, what could be the repercussion of it? Especially now, since we're in a time where fake news is such a big thing and it's causing problems in this pandemic especially. So all of those things are very, very important, and being accurate and being very alert is very important. Try to make minimal mistakes. Then of course, there is this, you know, option of course, working in this sector with the understanding that this is not something which is full-fledgedly always going to be glamorous, or it's always going to be interesting, or it's always going to be fun. Well, it's not always fun, it's not always glamorous, and it's not always, you know, amazing, and there's a lot of story happening, a lot of stuff happening across courts. But when you like doing something, I think that you make peace with the fact that there will be some good days and there will be some not so good days. And usually, you know, there is no nothing sensational about legal journalism. So a lot of times people who are in the news sector, who are journalists, not particularly legal journalists, they are able to find news which creates sensation, or they are made, they do it to create sensation from it. But in legal journalism, the probability of something being sensational is very small, luckily, and it's all factual based, but how you report it matters, right? So I'll come to how you report it and how it can differ from person to person. And so yes, there is nothing sensational about it, there is nothing big about it all the time. But yes, sometimes arguments in courts also go viral, and lots of arguments have gone viral in the past, but that does not happen every day. It happens like once or twice in like 2-3 months where an argument has gone viral, unlike news which goes viral almost every day. So that way it's not always very fun or anything, but it's good if you enjoy it. And like I say, I think for somebody who's interested in getting into this sector, especially from college, should be able to intern in a media house as a court reporter and get some experience, get some ground knowledge of how it works. And even if they're not able to report through a media house or intern through a media house, if they're in college, they can directly go to the Supreme Court and see how, you know, just practice if they're good at it. I wish I had done that in college. So yes, that really works. That could really help kind of build your base when you're students and when you're in college, and it could get you better opportunities later. Right. And then, of course, I'd like to talk about, you know, how there are certain aspects apart from accuracy, apart from being alert, apart from being articulate, apart from just knowing your way around the courts, understanding the arguments. There is one thing which is very important for legal journalists, and that is ridding themselves of personal biases when they are reporting. Now, what I mean by that is that when you enter a courtroom as a court reporter, as a legal journalist, you are going in only with your mind and only with your skills of reporting, which are of being articulate, of jotting down whatever's happening. And you're leaving everything else behind, out the door. What that everything else is personal biases, is political ideologies, is religious affiliations, is likes, dislikes towards people who are probably the litigants, towards the lawyers who are arguing the matter, towards judges. And let's be very straightforward, everybody has those. But when you're reporting, you can't get that in the way of your reporting skills. All of those things, your ideologies, now everybody has those. You're human, and I don't think there's anybody in the world who doesn't have a specific way of thinking or a specific ideology, all of those things. So all of those things have to be left out of the courtroom. And I think even as journalists who are regular journalists, I mean, I'm no authority to say it, but I think even journalists should be able to do that. Rid themselves from personal biases when they're reporting or when they're doing some kind of journalism. And, you know, making sure that when you're reporting the matter, you're only doing it as it is being spoken in the courtrooms. You tell the world what was going on in the courts, what was being argued. You don't tell the world what you think about what was being argued. What you think about it goes to your opinions, goes to your columns, goes to your personal thinking. It does not go to your reporting. And, just the aspect of, you know, being very particular about the fact that I think lawyers also would understand what I'm trying to say here, because it's very important to segregate your personal and your professional personalities. generally in life, from what I feel, even when I was practicing, you know, your professional individuality and your personal individuality, if you kind of club it together, the combustion, you know, how they intermingle together would probably create a very volatile personality. And that could not work. For a lot of people, it works, and that's great, but for me, it doesn't. So that segregation from your personal thinking, your professional thinking is very, very important, especially even more so in the courtrooms. Going back to the fact that you then have to be alert, I think court reporters have to be even more alert than the lawyers who are arguing the matters. I don't mean no disrespect, but what I mean is that lawyers have their files in front of them. They have, you know, the judges to prompt them. They have the opposite side to prompt them. They have a battery of juniors often to prompt them if they missed out something. But when you're a court reporter, you're there on your own trying to make sense of what is going on and trying to figure out what is going on and reporting exactly what is being said. Oftentimes, I have entered a courtroom and, I want to start my day, begin my day, and I'm very pumped about it, that, you know, this matter, I'm waiting for that item 20 to come and I'm going to report it. But, you know, suddenly what happens is that there's item 5, which I did not pay attention to in the cause list. And generally, you know, nobody paid attention to it in the reporting fraternity. And we find out that it is a very, very important matter. And how we find that out is because all industry stalwarts are arguing the matter, and there are something, you can just figure out from arguments that, you know, this is something important, this is something worth being out there. And immediately what happens then, I immediately have to pick on small words that are being argued, because I have no idea what's going on, and then kind of immediately Google it, do my research there and then, and then pick up from there and start reporting, live reporting it. So that happens a lot. And yes, that is why I'm saying that it's very, very important to be quick and very, very important to be up and about. You can't waste a minute. If something's going on, you have to report it. If something worth reporting is going on, you have to be out there and report it. Okay. Also, I think the fact of being able to create a good piece, what does it require? When you're creating a story, say a court report of a matter, I think the most important thing about that will always be the heading of the matter. What goes out, these notifications that you get from all of these websites that you probably, or these apps that you probably downloaded on your phone, the headings that you see, the first thing, that notification that comes to you, that is the first thing that a person will see on their phone or when they open a website or perhaps when they open the channel in the TV. And these headings, I'm only talking about court reporting and not other aspects of journalism. I think these headings are extremely important and they have to be very precise. They have to be very, they don't have to be very detailed. But they basically have to get out there what happened in 170 to 200 letters. And that is what is required. You have to have the right form of headings. You can practice doing headings, I think. Somebody who is wanting to get in the field and who are law students should, you know, read paragraphs, read judgments, or just read stories. I mean, you don't have to necessarily read legal judgments and legal stuff to be able to up your skills of writing anything. So, I mean, read judgments, but it's okay not to sometimes. So what you should do is you should practice, making headings out of paragraphs and trying to understand the context of it and get it checked from somebody who you think is a good, source of giving you marks about it. Excuse me. And the structure is, of course, the heading first, and then the first 3 lines or 4 lines of your piece of your court report is also extremely important. Now, that also explains and that also tells what is happening, what happened in the court on that particular day, or what has been happening also. So it kind of is a crux of everything, three or four lines. And then of course there has to be a structure to it. Grammar has to be very well laid out, especially if you're reporting in Hindi or English. I don't know about other languages. Grammar, I'm sure, is going to be extremely important everywhere. So Hindi, English, grammar, whatever sector you're in, whatever language you're reporting in, that is very important. You must be very good. Vocabulary is not something that you need to have, to be fairly honest. A lot of people emphasize a lot on using very fancy words, but I think that's not something that you need to have to be a good reporter or to be a good journalist for that matter. It's an added advantage, but it's not the only thing that you need. You need to be just articulate. You just need to be able to be fluid when you're writing. Just like lawyers are fluid when they're arguing, you have to be fluid when you're writing. So yes, that is one thing. And then, so I'd also like to talk about one more thing, that is having an eye for news. Like I said, that sensationalism is something that is pretty much lacking in legal journalism. And that's a great thing, especially for a person like me. But yes, eye for news, what does it mean? A lot of people say you should have an eye for news, you know, this, that. But what is eye for news? Eye for news is to be able to extract information out of a word that you hear in court or from a person, and being able to tell that, yes, this is something that I need to work on. This is something that I need to begin writing on. This is something that I need to start preparing a piece on, or an opinion on, or a column on. That is having an eye for news. And that's how you generate leads also for stories. Now, everything that you see out there in the news is not always something which has been tracked before. Something new also comes up. So how do you reach out? How do you find out what is the background of it? That is where relationships also count. The relationships that you form with people in courts. That doesn't mean that you have to treat everybody like how do you extract information out of somebody? No, that's not what I mean. But just knowing people and being nice helps you to, helps them to help you and you to help them. So that's how the relationship works. And it's very important to build that from the beginning, and it helps in your career as you progress, I think, in all sectors. So especially in court reporting. There's a word that journalists often use, and that is called source. But I have an immense issue with that word, because sources, if you treat somebody like a source, they will treat you like a parasite. So you don't have to do that. Treat a person like a human being, find out what you need to know, and that's that. And then of course, make sure when you're preparing reports, you use smaller paragraphs, you pay extreme attention to the grammar of it, the structure of it. You should be able to maintain the sense that you're trying to make out of the piece. So if the first line says something, there has to be some connection to the first paragraph and the last paragraph, right? It can't be here and there and everywhere. So it has to have a connection. It has to be framed accordingly. And only when you read it and you're honest to yourself, you'll be able to tell if actually it makes sense to you or not, I think. If you read something and you think, oh, it's amazing, then of course, you will never be able to improve. You should read it, find out if there are more important details, something legal that I can add to this. This lawyer had specifically argued about that act. So let's find out what is more relevant in that act. Don't add on in court reports, but try to sieve through information and kind of join them together. I think that's very important. Okay, so lastly, I think I would like to say that a lot of people ask me often, what is the scope in legal journalism? What is the, is there even scope in this sector? Now, this is a question that I've often been very irritated with since I passed out of law school itself. I think, and this is my personal opinion, a scope of any particular sector gets created when you're good at it and when you work hard at it. So it can be anything. It can be, for all you know, knitting something at home. If you're good at it, then you will be, there will be scope for it. And being good at it means having experience at it, being able to get out there and do your thing, being creative, and you know, being allowed to use your creative juices and doing things in this particular sector. So yes, there is scope, especially now, since let's answer it more straightforwardly, there is scope especially now. All news channels, like I said, now have legal reporters, have legal journalists. They are portals, they are now websites, they are you know, newspapers, they are social media pages which are in this sector of journalism. I mean, the number is so huge that you can't even count them your fingers. So there is scope, and all of them, all these organizations need reporters, need legal journalists. So yes, there is scope in this, and it is a great sector to be in. But you have to like it, just like you have to like litigation. You have to like working in the corporate sector, in the private sector. This is something to be good at it. This is again something that you need to like in order to be good at it. And lastly, another thing that I would like to say is that, whenever, for me, I think I was lucky to be able to work to be able to do two things at once, because I was given that kind of thing by my employers. That is the posh sector and the legal journalism sector. And I think that it is possible to manage two things at once. I mean, that is something that I'm saying currently. Of course, never say never. But being interdisciplinary is possible, and it does not mean that you will remain a, you know, jack of all trades and master of none. If you enjoy doing two things and you are able to manage two things, yes, it's all right to do both. You are not being you know, unfair to the other thing. If you can manage both, you can manage your time, it's great. You should be allowed to do that. I'm grateful to my employers that allow me to, you know, use my creativity somewhere else, if everywhere else, in fact, for that matter. That kind of independence has to be given by employers, and they have to have trust in people who work for them. I think that is extremely important. I think I'm pretty much done. Okay, so yeah, sorry. So the questions. I'm sorry, I did not have a look at these. Ravi asks, how much research does a reporter put in to understand the background and intricacies of legal point in order to understand the observations in right context and reporting it accurately? Like I said, Ravi, you know, the background, sometimes it has to be so quick. It has to be done in a minute. When you're in the courtroom and there's an important matter, you have to report it live. It has to be so quick sometimes that within a minute you have to find out everything about it. And you have to Google from, you know, small words that these lawyers are speaking. What is this judge speaking? Okay, this important word he spoke, let's Google this. So yes, there's a lot of research which is required, live and otherwise. When I'm writing a report, I think report I've pretty much covered. When I'm writing a column on a legal issue, the kind of research that I do is not centric to Google, and it's not centric to just judgments. It's a lot of research papers that I also look at from independent sources. I try to make sure that I read only from independent sources and not from any particular organization. I try my best to do that because when you're putting your opinion out there, it should be not biased. It should be more of information and knowledge apart from being, you know, being biased. So yes, there's pretty much a lot of research that we put in. And like lawyers, we do use the usual Manupatras, SEC Online's law. What is that? There's this particular website that we use that all the time. And of course, Google is your best friend. All right. At times when simply a petition is filed in court, its draft is made, Tarveen sir asks. At times when simply a petition is filed in court, its draft is made available in media and sometimes even published. How does it happen? Is the consent of the lawyer always taken? Okay, yes, sir, Tarveen sir, when we are publishing a particular petition in a particular portal, consent of that particular lawyer is taken always. If they say specifically that we don't want the petition to be published, we don't publish it. Also, I would like to say that there was a very, very interesting piece that I read a couple of days ago of one of my colleagues who is working in the Center for Law Policy Research, Balu. He had written about this. He says in his piece that I don't remember exactly. There was a gap in terms of the legal aspect of this, whether petitions have they are protected by the IPR rights. So there is a gap in that aspect. And but till the time there is a gap, it's being used, and I think it shouldn't be a problem because usually lawyers they give the hand over the petition to the reporters. And the consent is usually always there. Okay, Mr. Ankur says, how would you describe your journey at A Good Place? Litigation charm was excellent, or present one is too par excellent and enticing? Well, honestly, there is no comparison between both sectors. Both were amazing, but because I will be more, I will be unfair if I say one is better than the other. They both come with their own charm. Being a litigation lawyer is just a different feeling altogether. Being a reporter is a different feeling altogether. You're part of different fraternities altogether. So both things are just amazing. And I like being a court reporter. I like being a posh consultant also. So both these things I like more. So I would say that I find that more interesting and more exciting than being a litigation lawyer, currently at least. You never know what happens in life. So you never know. Okay, there's one more question which says, why you not speak in Hindi? I can speak in Hindi, but I was not instructed by Tarveen sir to speak in Hindi. I'm very well read in Hindi also. I have studied Hindi till class 12, till class 10. But, okay. Any more questions? I'm just perusing through if there are any. Pretty much it. If there are any questions, you can type them in. I'm tuned in for 2 more minutes and then I'll switch this off. Also, one thing I did not cover was courtroom exchanges. I wanted to talk about that. Courtroom exchanges is the lighter side, the lighter vein of courts. That is something that is one of my most favorite things that to do when I'm working as a court in the Supreme Court. Now, what happens in courts sometimes? You know, sometimes lawyers and judges, the bar and the bench, are exchanging very interesting comments with each other, and it is humor, pure humor. So, to kind of report them and finding a crux of it is very, very interesting sometimes. You have to have sometimes an eye for it and a sense of humor to be able to understand what is going on. And that is one thing also that you should work on if you're wanting to get into the sector. Okay, what would you advise to any lawyer who's interested in legal journalism? Tarveen sir, any lawyer who's interested in legal journalism? Like I said, if you think that you want to do it and you don't have a particular organization currently that you're associated with for legal journalism, since you're going to court and you're a lawyer, try sitting in court. Try to make sense of first, if you're able to understand what's going on. Of course, you're a lawyer, you might be able to figure out what's going on. After that, try to jot down in your own words quickly on your phones, type it out what you think is going on. And do it to practice this on your own, do it to yourself, and see if you're good at it, if you're able to polish that skill. And if you're good at it, you're able to polish that skill, then opportunities will come. For law students, I think interning with an organization that is in the sector is extremely important. I never did that in law school because I never really thought that I would get into this sector. But if you know you want to get into the sector, perfect, try to intern with a particular media house. Also, another advice is that don't be scared of jumping in from litigation to this sector. It's not something to be scared of. Just because everybody says that don't leave litigation, don't not take the chance. If you like it, then you should go for it, I think. All right, I think I'll log out now. Thank you so much for this opportunity, sir. Thank you. Bye, everybody. Thank you.